Good morning. A brief announcement before we begin our service this morning. Beginning next week, Sunday, June 7th, we will start our public worship services again. They will be on Sunday at 8 and 10 o'clock. We will not be having a Monday service for a few more weeks or a short time. Those services will look different than they have in the past. We will be practicing social distancing. We'll be blocking off every other pew. We are highly recommending that people wear face masks. We also realize that there will be some that will be very comfortable in coming back to St. Paul's, and there will be also those who are very comfortable in waiting for a little while. That's okay. We want you to know that whenever you may return or visit St. Paul's, you are always welcome. We will continue to serve your needs electronically as we've been doing over these past months. The services will be recorded on Sunday morning. The services will be edited and hopefully put up online at the latest by Sunday evening. They will carry a little bit different flavor than we've been doing the last couple months since we're once again back in church. But it is also our hope to bring some of those variations and different opportunities that we've been having into our worship services as we continue to go forward here at St. Paul's. Once again, welcome. If you have any questions, there's a lot of information on our website. Please take a look at our plan at stpaulsfranklin.org. Good morning and welcome to St. Paul's. Today we celebrate the festival of Pentecost. 50 days after Jesus had arisen from the dead, 10 days after he had ascended back into heaven, Jesus sent his disciples a gift, the gift of the Holy Spirit. And it was a gift that not only did he give to those disciples, but a gift that he continues to pour out upon the Christian church. And so today we celebrate that festival of Pentecost. May God bless your worship this morning.
Cover. be clear for all the world to see.
Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness.
Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins. And trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
I bring my guilt to Jesus.
God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given His only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ, and by His authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I long to be like Jesus. His Son purifies us from every sin. In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord.
Our scripture reading for this morning, and also our sermon text for this morning, is found in the book of Acts chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, A sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language?" Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd, "Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." Here ends our reading.
Speak with bravest fire and have the gift to all inspire, but have not love, my words are vain as sounding brass and hopeless gain. Give all I possess and striving soul my love profess, but not be given by love within. The prophet soon turns strangely thin. Thank you.
Mercy and peace be to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear Christian friends, his name was William Carey. He would later sometimes be called the father of modern missions. He was born in England in 1761. At the age of 14, he became a shoemaker. At the age of 18, he became a Christian. After that happened, William began to proclaim the message of Jesus to anyone who would listen. He would often stand even on the street corners and on street proclaiming the message of Jesus at the age of 18. At the age of 19, William married a woman named Dolly. It wouldn't be long after that that William got into his mind that he wanted to go to a country that didn't have many Christians in it at all. And so William wanted to go to India, a country of millions of people with very few believers in Jesus. But it was a country that had very harsh conditions. William tried for a while to convince his wife to go along, and she refused. But finally, she agreed. And they traveled to India with no church, not a whole lot of anything. The conditions in India were harsh. They even would lose 3 children, and because of the conditions that they were living in, the conditions of poverty, heat, and malaria, that eventually William's wife would lose her sanity. But that didn't stop William from proclaiming the message of Jesus. For 6 years, he proclaimed that message on a daily basis. And for 6 years, no one became a believer in Jesus. It wouldn't be until year 7 that he finally would get his very first believer convert to Jesus. I think if you looked at William Carey, you would say, really? A church of one that would take 7 years. It wasn't much to look at. When you looked at those men who stood on the top of the mountain and watched Jesus ascend back to heaven, they weren't much to look at. They returned to Jerusalem, and there they went to the temple and stayed there waiting. They weren't really much to look at. Jesus had given them an assignment. Before he ascended into heaven, he said, "You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Samaria and to the ends of the earth." But how was that going to happen? I think it would be an awful, daunting task. You will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. 11 people were going to do that. If you looked at that group of men, perhaps you might even look at them and say, they seem to fail. He was hands down the world's greatest preacher. He could make perfect illustrations. He knew how to weave words in sentences. He could paint the perfect question and answer the easiest or the hardest question that ever was asked of him. Thousands of people followed him. But slowly they began to drift away. The preacher's name was Jesus. When he ascended into heaven, we are told in the book of Acts that there were only 120 believers in Christ. Quite a drop from the thousands that first had followed him. Can't help but wonder that maybe the disciples at least might have had in their hearts and said, we want to get back to those glory days. And maybe even look to the world that perhaps Jesus had failed. There wasn't much to look at. But Jesus had given his disciples a promise. He had given his church a promise. He had said to them, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father has promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. They returned to Jerusalem, and there they waited. They waited for that plan to happen. They waited for God's big plan. And boy, did God have a plan for them. A plan that was be much bigger than they possibly could ever have imagined. 10 days after Jesus had ascended back into heaven, they were in Jerusalem celebrating the festival of Pentecost, the festival of weeks in the Old Testament church. That festival was one of three festivals that every male Israelite was required to go to Jerusalem. It was a festival that celebrated the early harvest, 10 days after Passover. And because Passover would bring millions of people in, there would be perhaps 1 or 2 million that would stay around there for that 10 days to celebrate Passover, to celebrate Pentecost. And then it happened. The disciples were in a room. The sound of a rushing wind went through that room. But that wasn't the gift that Jesus promised. We're told that there were tongues of fire, flames that floated above the disciples' heads. That wasn't the gift that Jesus had promised. They heard the disciples speak in various language to people that were there in Jerusalem, but that wasn't the gift either. God kept his promise. He sent them the gift of the Holy Spirit. He gave them that gift. He gave them the power to bring people to the trust in Jesus. What a gift it was. What an event that happened on that first Pentecost. We're told this morning in our text that there were 3,000 people that came to believe in Jesus on that day. When Peter stood up and he proclaimed that message with all the power of the Holy Spirit behind him, people listened to those words of Peter. They listened to the words of the other disciples. We look at that number that came to faith in Jesus on that day of Pentecost. We marvel. 3,000 people came to believe in Christ that one day. It's a remarkable number, isn't it? But have you ever wondered why God recorded that number in the New Testament? A number is not recorded in any other place when it talks about the Christian church anywhere else in the New Testament. So why now? Why that number of 3,000? Sometimes we look at that number, we marvel at it and think, wow, look what they had done. 3,000 in one day. But maybe there might be another reason why God gave us that number. Remember that at that festival of Pentecost, Jerusalem might have had as many as 1 to 2 million people. If you compare 3,000 to 1 or 2 million people, that's really a pretty small number, isn't it? And it was a message of Jesus that was proclaimed to people who already believed in God. They knew the Old Testament. They knew the promises of God. They knew what God had done for his people. And so on that day, 3,000 began to trust in Jesus. On the day of Pentecost, when Peter stood up before the people and he began to proclaim that message of Jesus, he connected the dots. He suddenly took these people who were from the promises of the Old Testament and connected them to Jesus. How Jesus had fulfilled every single one of those promises. But for that small group of believers in Jerusalem that day, there was a lot of work to do yet. Yes, 3,000 people perhaps came to faith in Jesus that day, but the percentage was pretty low, pretty daunting task that faced them. And yet God would use this small group of men to take this message of Jesus to the world. He would take these men who could not at first understand how they possibly could take this message to the ends of the earth, who could not possibly imagine the big plan that God had for them. And they would see how God would keep his promises. They would see the work of the Holy Spirit in their lives and the Christian church. We've been through some interesting times in the last couple months, haven't we? As you perhaps have seen, that next week, Sunday, we once again will try to begin worship services face-to-face here at St. Paul's. And we know that there will be those who will be comfortable in coming here, and perhaps those of you may still wait for a little while, and that's okay. But boy, we look forward to seeing you. On a personal note, I just have to say, I miss so many of you. I miss talking to you face to face. And it's going to be really nice next weekend to see some of you. Others might wait, and that's okay. And it's pretty amazing what God has done, though, in these last couple months. When this began back in March, who would have guessed that we would have gone this long? Who would have guessed that we would be preaching to a camera, claiming the message of Jesus to the world through online electronic means? But perhaps God had a blessing for us that we don't fully realize. Every week, as we posted these services on our website, on Facebook, and on YouTube, there are some numbers that are behind those videos that most of you don't get to see, but that I can see. And there's some remarkable numbers. That when you look, for example, at Facebook, for some reason, in some manner, and somehow, there are people from 20 different countries all over the world. We have seen our services, our Facebook page. I have no idea how that is happening. Hundreds of people are every week watching the services here at little old St. Paul's in the little corner of the world named Franklin. And those numbers are growing. If I were to guess, and I still don't understand all the numbers and how to get to them all, there are at least 300 to 400 people, if not more, who are watching us, hearing the message of Jesus. And I know there are many people who look at what is going on in this world and are frustrated and afraid. and it felt like the doors have been slammed shut. But I also want you to remember and to think that even though some doors have been closed, the Holy Spirit opened up some windows. The message of Jesus has gone out to this world, perhaps in ways that have never happened before. Because you see, God keeps his promises. When you looked at William Carey and the church that he began there in India, it wasn't a whole lot to look at. Perhaps for quite a while you could have said that maybe he simply was a failure. But with 200 years of time, from that humble beginnings of proclaiming that message in a country, do you know how many people in that country believe in Jesus? Numbers that I found said that there are 28 million believers in India who know their Lord and their Savior Jesus. In fact, Christianity is now the third largest denomination religion in India, behind Islam and Hindu. Small beginning. A beginning that looked like a failure. But God carried out his plans. When you looked at those disciples on that first Pentecost, how were 11 men going to carry out this message of Jesus to a world? But given a couple thousand years, God's church has grown. And it has grown significantly. And that message of Jesus has been carried out to the ends of the earth. And even sometimes here, in unusual ways, the message of our Savior Jesus has not only gone out to the people of Franklin and this small part of our world, but it has also gone out to the world. My dear friends, God has a plan for us. God has a plan for each of us. Don't underestimate the plans of our God. And so this morning, we give thanks that everyone who calls in the name of the Lord will be saved. Amen. May the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We pray. Dear Lord God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for the opportunities that you give us in our life to proclaim your message to people. We give thanks for the Holy Spirit who works that faith in the hearts of people through that message of your word. Your word has gone out to this world. You had a plan. You had a plan that this message would be sent to the corners of the earth. And you have used your disciples and other people in history, and even have used us to carry that message out to the ends of the earth. May you continue to be with all of us. Help us to share that message of Jesus. Send the Holy Spirit to work heart faith in the hearts of people. And on this festival of Pentecost, may we give thanks for the work of the Holy Spirit. In your name we pray. Amen. We join in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Thank you.
last moments He may befriend us, and as homeward we journey attend us. Lord, have mercy.
Have mercy.